I am humbled and grateful to be able to stand before you today and offer a report on church planting. Let me pray for us as we begin. Lord Jesus, your apostle Paul asked the rhetorical question, how can they hear unless someone be sent? Father, give us the faith to send church planters into neighborhoods and communities all across this nation for the glory of the Lord Jesus and the building of his kingdom. I pray in his name, amen. Well, let's talk about church planting for a few minutes. Oh, shoot, that's not so. That isn't supposed to be in there.
Out of order.
That's supposed to be in my slideshow, Fun Things I Did Last Summer. I'm so sorry. We're not used to being Stanley Cup champions in St. Louis. So seriously, let's talk about EPC church planting. Our motto, every church in the EPC, a parent, a partner, or a patron of church planting. Currently, as far as we can tell, there are about 50 to 55% of our congregations are involved in some way in church planting. So we're on our way, but we're not there yet. Ed Stetzer, who is probably the leading authority in church planting in the last 30 years in the United States, said this: if a denomination or a network just wants to break even, it has to plant at an annual rate of 3%. So if you had 100 churches, that would be 3 new churches per year. A 5% increase is needed to grow, and a 10% increase is needed to thrive. We want to be thriving in church planting. Our national leadership team has that as a stated goal. We want to be a church of family of churches that take seriously the opportunity to share the gospel through church planting. So where are we today? Just a very brief update to let you know roughly where we are this morning. We are at about a 7% rate of church planting, so we're a little bit above holding steady, but not quite thriving. But that is, that's, I would call that good, steady progress for us. We have 9 church planting networks around the country, and I won't take time to go into all of those, but those are in cities and in areas where a group of churches have come together to partner to be church planting. In 2018, 3 of our church plants grew up, and they moved out of the house, and they're not coming back in. We don't have a philosophy in our church planting where your grown kids get to come back and live in the basement. So we want to keep that going. We want to see every one of our church plants become their own church. And this is, I want to mention this quickly because this is a first for us. I was contacted last year by the Presbyterian of Florida and the Caribbean, and they asked me to come and consult with them a little bit about church planting. And the end result of that is we now have a presbytery in our denomination that has hired a full-time church planting director. And that you should cheer for that. That is wonderful. They have taken a financial risk to invest in this, and they're pushing ahead. They've hired their staff member. He's come on board. So we're excited about that. The next thing I want to mention is our resolve as a national leadership team to broaden our understanding of church planting beyond just kind of planting church that look like us today. And so we want to be committed. Your national leadership team is committed to focusing on planting in underserved and unreached communities. The Presbyterian Church typically is pretty good in middle class, upper class communities, but that does not define the United States of America, and it certainly does not define the kingdom of God. And so we want to make sure that we are casting the net as wide as we possibly can. And to that end, instead of giving you some data, let me invite you just for the next 5 minutes to watch the screen. We want to tell you one story of a church plant that's working in an underserved community.
Thank you.
So if you ask the question, who in the EPC can be involved in something like this? The answer is everyone. One of my favorite things about this church plant of Lake Forest is the Presbytery took initiative with Lake Forest and said, we want to be partners on this one. So quite honestly, every church in the Presbytery of Mid-Atlantic who is fulfilling their per member asking is participating in this EPC church plant that'll be Spanish speaking, because they're partnering in funding the startup, and that's a joy. They partnered in interviewing Victor. They've been a part of the leadership. Really, it starts though with where our church started, which was at the session level, are we committed to somehow, some way, some form, being a church planting church? We did not have a plan. We did not know what it would look like. We didn't know if it would be partnering with others or come directly out of us, but we started with the commitment, do we believe that this is God's calling through the EPC to every one of our churches? And our session decided, yes, it is. And a certain percent of our mission budget will be dedicated to that in perpetuity. So that was the decision. And then it's just, once we decided, God, where are you opening doors or giving us opportunities or giving us a passion to be involved? We came to the realization that 2 miles from where our building is the largest concentration of new neighbors in our end of the county. And those new neighbors are Spanish-speaking immigrant families.
I just stay dreaming that this place is gonna be full out of with the people from the Huntington Green community. And if there's an opportunity for you to be part of what the EPC is bringing on as far as planting a church, if you have a heart for the people, they are lost. And then that you want them to get to know Jesus as their Lord and Savior, that you want them to love their neighbor as themselves. Of course, most of all, love God. But if you love your neighbor, then you want to reach out to them with the gospel, this is a great opportunity for you to do that. Just by embracing them, loving them, ultimately God will do the work in their heart with the help of the Holy Spirit.
As you visit in the community, I find that the most important thing for most families is their youth. And when you come and look at the statistics, you find out that in the Hispanic community, you have a lot of gangs, a lot of children that are in trouble, a lot of pregnancies and a lot of things, because nobody's focusing on ministering to these kids. And I think in the EPC, or here with what Victor is doing, is ministering to those families and ministering to those needs. And that changes not only the lives of those families, but the lives of those children when they grow up for generations to come.
People are trying to recognize our gifts. They're trying to recognize our role and what we're trying to do for them. Not only meeting their physical needs, but spiritually. And their hunger for the gospel, their hunger to hear more about God. And so that's what we're here for.
I believe that the encouragement that I could give them is that, number one, they're not doing the work by themselves. They are doing the work that the body of Christ is supposed to be doing. So they need to plug in into the local church so they have a team effort. They have the support of the body of Christ. And as they go into the community to minister, they can work based on what the church already knows about the community, and they can get the support and prayer, human resources, facilities that we already have in our communities. So as they go to do their church plan, they're not coming in by themselves. They're coming in with a team of people.
We really want our whole congregation to own the vision of serial church planting, that this is as important a part of our ministry of Lake Forest as international missions, as local missions. We want this to become normative. Like any healthy church, I hope it's normative in the EPC. Any healthy church, oh, it's normal. What's wrong with our church that we're not a parent, partner, or a patron right now of church planting? An encouragement I would give to future church planters in the EPC is you're in the right denomination. The vision for church planting, the priority of it is really permeating our presbyteries and our congregations and our networks. And so, hey, ask, seek, and knock. And if you're really called to plant a church, there will be an opportunity for you. You're going to have to take initiative, and you're going to have to go after it, but there will be opportunity, and we're excited that that might be a calling for you.
So I want to take just a couple of minutes as I begin to wrap up and talk about where we're going from here, kind of what are some of the priorities that we're setting for the year, the next couple of years ahead. The first is that we want to be committed to creating a pipeline of new church planters. The EPC, we don't have a denominational seminary, and so it's a bit of a more of a challenge for us to go out and recruit. But we are actively involved in recruiting the next generation of church planters. But while we're doing that, we want to be very careful to take care of our current church planters. And so we have a few things that we're doing with our current church planters on an ongoing basis. Excuse me. We have cohorts for them. We have coaching. We've entered into a work agreement with a couple named Cron and Elizabeth Gibson. I don't know if you're in here or not. Are you in here? I don't think they're in here. I don't know if they have a red badge or not. But they will be actively involved throughout the year in intentionally counseling with our church planters, and if they're married, with their spouses, because we want to take good care of the family of the church planter. And then the last point there is community. We want, John Bueno said in that video, you're not alone. But if you have been a church planter in the past, or you are a church planter now, you know that it feels very lonely at times, and it can be very isolating, which can be very hurtful. So we want to make sure we are building community within our church planting family. So every year we do a retreat, and this fall we will have our retreat again. So this is my plug for you. If you have a church planter in your presbytery, or if you are a parent church and you have a daughter church plant and you have a church planter, make sure they go to that retreat. Make sure that you fund their transportation. We pick up the cost for their lodging and their meals while they're there for the planter and the spouse. And we intentionally want to grow that community. But you guys have to help them get there. But if you'll do that, we will take wonderful care of them, and we will just spoil them rotten over those 2 days in Colorado Springs. We're introducing something new this year. Mike Moses and his team have developed a bit of a curriculum that helps churches who want to plant but have never had any experience in church planting before. And they're not exactly sure where to start or how to go about, how do I get my session on board on this? Or as an elder, how do we get our pastor excited about church planting? Mike has put together a bit of a curriculum through Lake Forest, and Sandy Wilson did this for years at Second Pres in Memphis, and we're bringing those two folks to the retreat this fall. So if you are a ruling elder who is responsible for local outreach, i.e. church planting, or if you're a teaching elder and you would like to learn more about church planting, we want to invite you to come to the fall retreat this year and get a crash course in church planting. Every one of us has a part and a role to play, and I hope every church, I hope there's a day before I fade off into the sunset where we have close to 100% participation in our denomination for church planting. So I'm going to leave you with a picture of some of our church planters. I'm also going to ask any church planters in the room if you would please stand. And then I've asked Kirk Ackison, who is a church planter for us on the north side of Nashville. So church planters, if you're in the room, stand up. If you're near a church planter, get around them, lay hands on them. Yeah, you can clap for them, absolutely. Kirk Ackison is planting on the north side of Nashville, one of the poorest communities in the city of Nashville. I'm going to start crying, so I'm going to stop talking about it, because it's amazing what God is doing through him. But I've asked him to come and just pray for all of us to conclude our report.
Let's pray.